time for your thoughts, your questions, and I'll give it to you until you know how to deal with the
dissidents. Yes.
It's so over to you.
So please, I'm sure you have many, many thoughts and you could have equally spoken for as long as I did. So please. Yes.
The question is tolerance sufficient?
Want to say a little bit more, maybe an example of what you have in
mind? I mean, because you were talking about the director of the school in Nigeria, you mentioned tolerance again towards the end. It's one thing to be tolerant of another person, but another thing to have them hugging each other, like you have the picture of a Palestinian child and a Jewish child.
Yes.
So is tolerance enough in this move towards peace, or do we need to seek more than just tolerating the other?
I think that's a brilliant sort of pinpoint question. This can come up in lots of ways, also in terms of interpersonal relations and all kinds of things. And I think it's important not to use the word tolerance or compassion or altruism in a way that you might call mindless or thoughtless. And you have made a very, very important distinction, which I feel goes to the heart of the matter. There is a tremendous tendency to identify the person completely with their actions. And therefore, when we, for example, in many criminal justice systems, if a person commits a horrible act such as murder, then they are known as a murderer for their entire life. And it's even applied usually retroactively to their previous life, and they simply have this tag based on one action which was horrifying and harmful. And I think that many spiritual traditions, but also secular traditions which look at rehabilitation, reconciliation, and processes such as restorative justice, see it's extremely important to make a distinction between the totality of the human being and the unfortunate or unacceptable acts of the enemy. I think we can all see this very clearly about ourselves. We get accused for something, and then we feel, why am I being criticized? And we immediately rush to our own defense from the basis of, hey, maybe that was a mistake, maybe I shouldn't have done that, but don't dismiss the whole of me. Well, if you take that logic and apply it to these situations, then I think that opens up what I believe is actually always necessary in the final resolution of any armed conflict. Someone has to talk to the people they meet and who have committed horrific acts. And until you can get to that stage of moral courage and bravery on both sides, which ultimately rests upon going to that deeper level of understanding some kind of common humanity, then there are two things you can't do. You can't deal intelligently with the horrors of the past and the scars of the future. And you can't chart a meaningful way forward with the spirit of cooperation. So I really appreciate your bringing this out of my question.
So my question is, if we imagine the whole world with only one religion or without a religion, would we have the same problems that we're having right now?
Absolutely we would.
So it's not
so, this is a very important point. There's a political philosophy, I know you're not advocating it, but that takes exactly this point of view. It's called fascism. If only everybody thought the same and agreed with us, what a great place the world would be. And millions of people have been slaughtered in the pursuit of that idea. I know you're not advocating. You hear this in political statements, you hear it on the news. Something happens that people are really horrified by. And the talk of extermination begins. Let us exterminate those people one way or another, and then we can go back to where we were and all will be right. This hasn't worked throughout history. And it's brought dreadful pain and suffering as a consequence. So what's much more interesting is your question, which you're also posing there was one world. There was one world government, one political system. Somehow we all got all mushed up together into one thing, but we still have these problems. I would say, if you think about the questions that I posed at the end, we definitely would. Now, you just have to ask anybody who's in charge of a religion whether they have any difficulties within that religion. Of course they do. Just tremendous differences of interpretation of the scriptures, tremendous interpretation of differences about how family life should be organized, whether there should or shouldn't be contraception, whether it's okay to have abortion or not have abortion, whether this translation of the text is accurate or whether that translation of the text is accurate. If you're talking about a huge management challenge, it's managing a religion. I wouldn't say I manage a religion, I just happen to be in charge of some parts of the management of a small organization. And I can tell you, it's a very lively experience. And that's why it's so important to really go into these inner depths. And go, what makes it so difficult for me to work with other people? Especially people I agree with. You know, it's very easy to preach about learning to agree with people who disagree. But what about the challenge that many, many people face when they join an organization, when they join a community, and they agree with its ideas, and everybody is in favor of the same thing? And then they find all these arguments and frustration. And, you know, for example, people join a peace movement. I don't know if people have been in various peace organizations or peace movements. Why do people leave? They don't leave because war is such a difficult thing to deal with. They leave because of all the infighting, the intolerance of authoritarianism, and the people they can't stand. I guess I give the impression I know what I'm talking about. So I think this is why I think the subject is so challenging and why I believe it is so universal. Because there are things in our own makeup that we have to work with and can work with. And the people who have worked with those things become extraordinary peacemakers. We know how to make peace in a world whose strength is its diversity. So thank you for asking that question and giving me all excited about to meditate.
I have a question about the Shambhala principle, actually. Is the Shambhala principle and the emotional intelligence interrelated?
The word Shambhala comes from an ancient legend, some people say it's a human archetype within the human psyche. Some people say it has historical truth. It was the idea of an enlightened society. And the story goes that the king of this society, which is sometimes said to be at the confluence of East and West, embracing the Occidental and Oriental parts of the world, including the Arabic world. Others say it was a little further east in Central Asia. That the king of this kingdom heard that the Buddha was nearby and went to seek his advice. And said, "Do you have any advice for me as a king? Because I can't leave and become a monk. I have a country to run." And the Buddha is said to have given him a particular advice, which has come down to us today as what we call the teachings on enlightened society. And the principle on which this hinges is a term which means that essentially the human being and our experience is complete. Complete in the sense that everything that we need to be a completely worthy and enlightened being is already within us. This is the notion in the Buddhist tradition of enlightenment, which is not, it is not something which is acquired, but something which is already inherent and recognized. And so the notion of the Shambhala principle here, as it applies to this, is that, as I said to the lady here who asked the question about tolerance, there is no reason to exclude anyone from the conversation. Sometimes the people who are the most disruptive, whether if I may say so, in university, I don't know whether you have any disruptive people here, but the people who are upset about things, who make life difficult for them, maybe there's wisdom in their insight. Maybe there's something in their experience that they're, however poorly, trying to communicate. And the person who is wise in it and wants to govern the whole of society trains themselves to be able to listen to them and to listen to it deeply. It's the opposite of closing down with one of those questions put into the people I feel comfortable with and already agree with. So, is that related to the notion of emotional intelligence? I would say yes, in theory, because fundamentally it's about knowing oneself so fully that you can then know another person fully and know a society fully. Did you want to follow?
Yes, no.
Can I just say, I think a great example, maybe that sounded a bit theoretical, but I think if you read, for example, writings about Nelson Mandela and how he worked in those 27 years that he was apparently in solitary confinement, where he first studied to learn the language of his enemy. Then he embraced his jailers as his friends, and slowly began to go beyond the understandably partisan position that brought him at the beginning of the struggle to one that then was later to make him actually loved throughout the world, not just for what he did politically, but for his own personal change and what that meant to his nation, both those who supported him and those who once would have killed him. So that's the skill on which I'm thinking. Please.
The question is about, you mentioned like there are three main factors that drives people to act in a way that is against the religion of the faith.
Yeah.
You mentioned emotion, culture, and identity.
Yeah.
Don't you think ignorance of the religion and true knowledge of the religion is also another major fact. Another major, I mean,
if I what you mean by true knowledge of the religion, a deep understanding that the human being is greater than the sum total of its passing emotions, is greater than the limitations which are imposed upon it by culture, and is a far more dynamic being than a fixed identity. And then, of course, those who act in accordance with that have not understood or been penetrated by the truth of their religion. But if by religion you mean what we might call ordinary knowledge of the religion, or participation only in the religion's rituals, I'm sorry to say I have met people who were far more expert, for example, in my own religion, than I could ever hope to be, who could quote for far longer than I have spoken to you the sacred texts. And they are definitely, I would say, a strong emotion, culture and identity when they have, at times, which I have personally witnessed, called for genocidal acts against ethnic minorities in their countries. I you know, you can probably tell this is very troubling. Because it's, I don't know how you feel from the position of your faith. But when I see this being done, you can go on YouTube and you can see the most appalling hate speeches. Like people in the robes of my faith. That's why I approach this subject with a little humility, you know. Because then I could tell you it's only because of these three things. I might feel a little more comfortable. But there's also a depth of mystery to this, which is really short.
Thank you very much for your amazing speech. I really enjoyed listening to all your thoughts. And I actually have a question. Do you think that a regulation self-esteem and conformity would help into fostering the kindness education that we talked about?
Could you say that last bit again? I just was distracted by this piece of paper.
Sure. I say, do you think that self-esteem and, and conformity regulation can actually help into fostering the kindness education that we were talking about?
Yes. Okay, let me take the first point. It probably addresses the other two, which is about self-esteem. So I'm a visitor to the university, and I've only visited Morocco twice before in my life, so I absolutely do not know whether what I'm going to say is relevant in your society. But in the society that I come from, we have huge problems with what you refer to as self-esteem. From the, you asked about Shambhala principle, so in the sort of classical Shambhala teachings on the mind society, the era we're living in is described as a dark age. And a dark age is said to have two characteristics. One is extreme greed, and one is extreme aggression. So we can obviously see extreme greed in the world around us, especially in terms of economic injustice. We can see extreme aggression every day in terms of the horrors of war. There's also an internal dimension. So extreme greed is the feeling that there's something we're missing. There's something that we need. We're not good enough. We're not up to the task. And may I say that the advertising industry thrives on this. So if you, if you hear on Ryanair and the people, it really was very clear message that all my internal deficiencies would be solved if I would buy a much larger man's watch. So that's the, in that sense of lack. And then when it comes to the aggression, that lack can feed a sense of actual self-loathing. And you know, in the industrialized world, I certainly hope that this is not the case in your country. The latest statistics show that the single most common form of medication taken by people aged between 18 and 40 is antidepressant medication. So you can imagine, if you come from that place of deep self-doubt and self-loathing, the importance of the inner journey that one has to go through. Because in a way, the ability to engage with others and to engage with some of these larger issues, really, it's going to be helpful as to be preceded by first making friends or being kind with oneself, including those things.
I also want to share one of my thoughts. I believe that words can be stronger than violence in some situations. But don't you sort of think that those great peacemakers need more than words or manifestations? extremely powerful armies possessing weapons that could wipe them so easily?
They had a really global vision for peace. And if they had, in addition to their words and their vision, an incredibly strong army that could make that happen, do I think that's either a good idea or workable?
Not really, but defending themselves.
I ask a question similar to this about that, to that minister I mentioned about the civil rights movement in the United States. Now, admittedly, it was only his one man's opinion. And perhaps some of you have seen this historical photographs or been told about them, and then these people began to rise up, essentially out of slavery, although it moved on to segregation. They were met with overwhelming force, essentially by the police, and then at some stages later by others. And there were horrific pictures on the television at that time. And you may think I'm confessing everything from being a little boy, but I was a little boy and I saw it, and I remember it very vividly to this day. These defenseless people being attacked with fire hoses and dogs. Now, they won. And the people with fire hoses and dogs lost. What does winning and losing mean? Winning means that the aspiration that those people who were being attacked had eventually was adopted as a normative principle, at least in law, for the whole of their country. And it benefited not only them, but the people with the dogs and the fire hoses and their descendants. The vision that the people with the fire hoses and dogs had was, as that minister said, one of complete fear and resistance to change. And they thought that somehow this other idea could be defeated through terror. And I think that's a fundamental mistake they made, because they used a method that is only works for a short period of time. But in the very powerlessness of their victims, lay not only a vision, but a method that has long since outlasted. So, this is why some people say that to be a peacemaker takes far more bravery than to be a warrior. That's how I see it. And if I could just bring that back to what I was thinking, are we training ourselves in that? No. I have an idea. I have to share it with you briefly. I like to say to people, you know, why isn't there some incredibly wealthy foundation somewhere, or some trillionaire who would like to make a difference in the world? And he or she sets aside a huge part of money, and he or she invites the most brilliant specialists in all kinds of fields, including technology and computing and psychology and everything, and says to them, come up with a different set of strategies for dealing with violence. Where is that research? There is not one of them. You know, has anyone ever, for example, right? Everyone goes, okay, let's bomb them. Okay, has anybody ever done any modeling? For example, about tranquilizing people on a large scale, so they could be disarmed while unconscious without any loss of life. Now you might go, that's a ridiculous idea. Oh, that's a ridiculous idea? How about the idea that just bombing them is somehow or other going to end the conflict? So where is the creative work being done? Well, similarly, do you know how, I think there are three countries in the world that have ministries of peace. Three countries. So no wonder politicians, they say, what are we going to do? There's a very limited number of options that are presented to them because we're not even paying civil servants to come up with alternative strategies. So I think sometimes, I understand your question, comes from failing to realize that almost complete lack of imagination and complete lack of investment that could be at least comparable to what we spend and invest on war. To do as Martin Luther King Jr. said, that the people who are in favor of peace must think it at least as well organized as the people who are in favor of war.
I had a question about the, when you talked about the healing process that was done like in the streets of America, in Nigeria, by NGOs that were trying to reverse the trend of violence towards the trend of peace. I wanted to ask you, how do you think we could instill these values of kindness and acceptance of others in schools, like for children? Like today, most of the people we hate are not our neighbors. They might live like 150 kilometers away from us. But we only see them through like specific channels, like media, and it's a distorted image. We don't see the human, we see the image we are given of him.
Yes.
How do we do this? Do you think we should first like teach our children to accept each other so that they can accept people that others are different? Or should we skip this step and talk directly to the people we hate?
Well, I tend to think that that these are linked. So, first of all, it goes back a bit to the question that the person asked over here about self-esteem and all that sort of thing. As far as I remember, growing up is a very difficult and painful process. People later on talk about, oh, what a wonderful childhood I had, but you know, because you're going through all the personal change, you're stuck in a classroom with all kinds of other people you didn't ask to be there. And usually there's all kinds of stuff like that. So that's a great training ground where people can be trained, as you said, in that emotional intelligence, understanding, you know, what's going on within them. It's very important, for example, to be able to learn in yourself that aggression usually comes from fear. If you respond to the person on the basis of their aggression rather than their fear, you're making two big mistakes. First of all, by responding on aggression, you're only going to feed it. And you're actually missing the point. Because you want to actually relate to that person, and usually it's something much more tender that they're covering up, such as fear. So, gosh, wouldn't it be fantastic if, from a very early age, children not only in their schools, and say in their religious communities or whatever, but at their homes, were all learning about that. That would be very different kinds of thing. And then, secondly, I think there's an aspect of that can be taught about, we use a phrase in Shambhala called having difficult conversations. You know, like, how do you bring up something that you're really, really concerned about? That maybe you're worried about hurting another person, you're worried that they're going to be with you. And I know this is difficult, everybody knows it's difficult. But if you were to finally become a foreign minister of somewhere, and you have to start negotiations with a group that's been trying to destroy your country, you're going to have to engage in a difficult conversation. So why not start training large numbers of us for that? And I think that there's an aspect which you didn't mention there that is an incredibly important influence, not just on young people, but actually all of us. And I'd like to close with that point because I think it's what one thing I wanted to share with you. When I talked about culture, I mainly talked about people's individual or national or ethnic or religious cultures. There's also a world culture. And we're all influenced by world culture. then there is an aspect that we need to be very open about, which is that the level of aggression in world culture in our lifetimes has gone up. Not just mathematically in terms of fighting, but, for example, in terms of entertainment. You know, when I travel on planes and I look at what people are looking at on their screens, and then we'll get off at the other end, and someone says, how was your flight? And they say, oh, it was good. You know, they ask about the food, and nobody says, by the way, I sat there for 8 hours and was brainwashed by constant images of people shooting and killing. So then, when our politicians are asked, you know, what do we do? What's the first thing that comes to mind? How many stories do we know? How many great films are there about people who have chosen the path of peace and have really moved our hearts so that when crunch comes, we go, I'm doing that. Right? Similarly, the level of aggression, just in public discourse and politics, it's the norm. Now, I think that it takes real courage for anyone to resist these days, this bloodlust. And I believe that that's how we brought all of you here this evening, that this title is not very entertaining, is some realization that we have to find a way out of this incredible cycle of violence. And being here with all of you this evening, I have felt really touched by this strength in your hearts and minds. And when I was coming here, I was reminded of a sign I saw in the window in my home city when I was a kid. And I wanted to leave you with the times. So thank you all very, very much, and for your patience.